Hello and welcome to Rusty Junk. Look at us. For those who are watching on YouTube, the band's back.
We're all
We're all
back
back.
together.
Yeah, say hi,
Woohoo!
everyone.
Hello.
Hey, hey.
Hey. Yeah, that's what we want. It's been great, but it's so good to see everyone. And I just hope the film that we picked does it justice, but we will get there.
Before we get there, I just want to
Okay.
say thank you for standing in for me, Joe, for the film last time because I was poorly, and I probably couldn't have spoken. I sounded a bit like a Dalek, if anybody knows Doctor Who.
Oh yeah, well, no, we definitely missed you, and it was always my pleasure.
Oh, thank you.
Well, and thank you for standing in. Absolutely. But anyway, yes, we're back, and we'll get to the choice of film. We'll get to why we chose the film, and the reason why I'm been feeling pains in my back is because I think you've been sticking pins in a voodoo doll, or at least two of you have. But we are looking at the film that we chose, was the 1986 sequel to the very popular Karate Kid, which we'll get into, starring Ralph Macchio, Pat Morita, Martin Cove, Yuji Okamoto, others. Anyway, here's a trailer. Here's a trailer.
He is quicker.
Rule number one, karate for defense only.
He is wiser.
Rule number two, fast run rule number one.
He is stronger. Miyagi taught him well.
Secret of Miyagi family karate.
I don't get it.
Practice, you will.
Can you break a log like that?
Don't know. Never been attacked by a tree.
Miyagi discovered the man within the boy.
Never put passion before principle. Even if win, you lose.
Now Daniel must discover the man within himself.
In Okinawa, honor very serious.
Your sensei teach you how to fight with spear?
No more tournaments. No more cheering crowds. This time, the combat is real. Karate Kid, Part 2.
So, does somebody want to tell the story of how we selected this film? Does somebody want to say how we democratically picked this film? And it was democratic in the end.
Okay, so we had a WhatsApp group. And suggestions were put forward, and it was whittled down to two. So it was this film, or what was it, Star Trek 2?
No, Indiana Jones, the Temple of
Oh,
Doom.
Indiana Jones. Yes, Temple of Doom, which I think is an all right movie. So yeah, it went to coin flipping, but it wasn't enough that Charles flipped a coin on his own that we couldn't actually see on the video.
Hey,
And then
wait a minute. There's.
randomly, he showed like a 50 pence piece saying it was whatever the result was to actually choose Karate Kid. So even I thought, looks a bit sus this. So I thought we needed an independent, fair, adjudicated, watched kind of
Questioning my integrity.
coin toss, basically.
Okay.
So we had to get our daughter
No,
involved
we
as
had to
well.
film it. And then we had to get the daughter to choose between two pictures before we decided who was going to be assigned heads. I mean, good Lord. I mean, if only the American elections were conducted in such a way. And do you know what? I think I might as well be coin tossed these days. Just go for it. You might get a representative. I mean, you get an average of statistically 50-50.
I think decisions in our government are probably done on a coin, aren't they, at the minute?
Oh, we wish they were. Just done by breezes on the wind. But anyway.
What I don't get is what we had a choice of two films, one of
Yes.
which, Charlie, you declared that you couldn't stand and wouldn't watch. So,
Well,
that's what introduced the doubt into the integrity of the process, I think.
but I would always conduct a fair. I've lost in the past.
Yeah, I know, but you should have given us the choice of heads or tails. The person that's flipping the coin doesn't say, I'm heads.
Amy chose it.
No, the first time.
Oh, yeah. So that's car. Why I said it wasn't a fair flip. So.
And then the coin, like he flips it, he drops it. And then he's like, oh, there's the coin. It's on its heads. You know, it's like, that could have been a different coin.
I'll tell you what, my legal team will be in touch with you.
I still think slurs
against my good name here.
That's why I said, even though I did want to do Karate Kid 2, I just said, no, we've got to do something that's fair. So hence the involvement back at home in our kitchen with the daughter and the coin.
It's quite fun, though, to be fair, in its own way. Yeah. Created a little bit of tension. Can I just get the elephant in the room out of the way? I feel vindicated watching this film, by the way, that even Mr. Miyagi refers to it as karate.
He doesn't.
He does, though. He does, though. He does, though. And I'm like,
well, he calls it karate. He calls it karate.
And what do you call it?
I call it karate.
So you're wrong. So you're wrong.
We're both wrong. He calls it karate.
He doesn't. Yeah. He doesn't. There's a couple of times he went, karate, karate.
Mm.
Karate is very important. And you're like, oh, cool. Thanks, Mr. Miyagi. Thumbs up from Pat Morita. Thanks, mate.
It's all about inflection on the different part of the word.
Well, I will be using, everyone else will be using the posh version, and I'll be saying the correct version.
You're not saying the correct version.
According to the lead character. But
so. You're not.
We are going to have to return to his pronunciation of various words and whether his kind of pidgin English that he adopts throughout this film is... stands the test of time. So I wouldn't be using him as your benchmark of authenticity, to be honest. Chad.
That's true. And yeah, we need to discuss the whole speaking English in Japan for the 100% of the time.
Look, we've got a lot to discuss. So why don't we just get straight to it? I'm not flipping a coin toss for who goes first in this. So I'm just going to pick Joe. Joe, then Dom, then Amanda, and then me. There you go.
So I was one of the people that wanted Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom, but we ended up getting Karate Kid Part 2. And the great thing about this movie is it's hilarious. Like, this is something that should be on Mystery Science Theater 3000, because there's so many goofy things that go on in this movie. You know, I'll say, like, the first 10 minutes is kind of fun to watch because it's a recap of the first movie. But once they get to Japan, it just goes south pretty quick. It's fun, you know, and it's a kid's movie. Like, if I was watching this through the eyes of a kid, I'd love it. Like, if I was a teenager and say I took a girl to the movies to go see this, I bet you we would both love it, you know, because it's made for them. I don't think it's really made for adults. And that's why I wanted to see if Amy would have came on and what her thoughts would have been.
Yeah, like I think it's more a teen movie than
anything. Yeah.
So marks out of 10, Joe?
Marks out of 10, I would say a 5.
Okay. All right. Well, Dom, the Dom.
Yeah, I agree with some of what Joe says there, but I guess on the whole, I thought this is fairly thin fair, to be honest. It's a karate film with barely any fighting in it. So I thought the bits of it I liked. I liked Miyagi. I think he's a good character, and I like the kind of focus on his story. But I thought, if you're a teenager coming to watch this film in back when it was released, or nowadays, I think you'd find it odd. It's like almost like a travel documentary in parts. There's kind of no action, and if you really want a film that explores a surrogate father-son relationship, do you really turn to Karate Kid 2 for that? So, I don't know. I'm going to be more harsh than Joe, because I think if any film which includes not one but two separate Japanese tea ceremonies just isn't fast enough paced for me. So I'm going to give it a 4 out of 10.
Wow! Really wow! Harsh. Stunned. Yeah. Wow. Amanda.
Oh, well, I quite like the tea ceremonies. Thanks very much. You have to understand the intricacies of, the honour and the respect and the customs and traditions and stuff. Maybe, yeah, it probably doesn't fit in a tea movie, but I think you obviously saw that there was something bubbling between Ralph and the young Japanese girl, but obviously they weren't going to, like, you know, snog the face off each other. It's not that kind of dumb thing, is it, in Japan? Lots of respect going on. So, you know, it was only a fitting way, I quite enjoyed that. I thought it was quite sweet. Overall, yeah, I've not seen the film before. I've watched Karate Kid, the first one, and I thought that was all right. So I'm giving this a 6 because I thought it was entertaining. Yeah, there are some, like, really odd, some odd stuff going on, basically. The use of panpipe music was one. The lack of karate going on was another. And the whole kind of everyone spoke English and this whole kind of rift between families thing, I thought was a little bit overextended. But yeah, I quite enjoyed it. If I'd have been a teenager, I would have enjoyed it just as much, I think.
Wow. Okay. Well, to echo that point and to take your point as well, Joe, you're right. When I saw this, I was 14. And did I think that in Breaking the Ice, the six, not three, as everyone else is doing, six panels of ice was one of the coolest things I've ever seen. Yeah. Add in Peter Cetera, Glory and Love. Actually, I think it's a great film because I'm a big Chicago fan. And then the bit at the end, I actually came out, went home and tried to make one of the drums. That's how into it I was.
Oh my God.
And I just thought, I love this. This is everything that I want from a sequel. This is everything. However, an apology to Harrison Ford and all the makers of Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. I'm sorry I picked this because this does not weather well at all. It doesn't. It might be one of those things where you watch it and you go, "Oh, guys, it's really, really, really brilliant. It's really amazing," and then you put it on, and then you're watching it at the same time as the person that has never watched it. Not that this happened in this case, but there's been times when I've gone, "Oh, this is really good," and then watch it. Willow, for example, do you remember?
Oh, for God's sake! Don't ever make me watch Willow again.
I'm so sorry for making you watch Willow because I remembered it being amazing, and I sat there embarrassed after about 45 minutes going, "Oh God, how long is this film again?"
It was
absolutely dreadful. This film is not as bad as Willow. However, it's 4 out of 10. I can't watch this again.
Oh, 4?
I can't watch this. Look, it's got some there's so much wrong with it, which we'll get to. I mean, we're all going to bring different things to this, but the acting in this and some of the writing is dreadful. And a teenager would let them get away with it, but we don't. I'm going to skip forward.
That's pretty bad.
Yuji Okamoto, the guy that played Chosen, rubbish. And I mean, rubbish throughout the entire film.
Really? I thought he was the best part. Oh, one of the best parts. He was a good bad guy.
The guy who played God. What?
Chosen. We're going to be going in and using different names. And
the nephew.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, okay.
Dreadful. Every time he did it, it's like he's reading off a card behind. Pretty much because he might have been. But no. Every time he came on, I was like, can you get on Kamiko? She was all right. The love interest for Daniel.
The thing that I made me a bit annoyed was, what's his name? I only watched it earlier. Sato.
Yeah.
Why did he have to talk like he was angry all the time? It was Yogi. Like a character out the Muppets.
But it's like it's like when we went to Greece and we see people like behind the bar talk to each other, and you think,
oh,
are they really? Have they fallen out? And then you ask them, and they go, no, this is the way we talk to each other. But my God, they look like they're going to punch each other. But it's just a thing. It's just a way, I suppose. But before we get into let's do roll call because it's going to be really short because there's not a lot to discuss. Well, there is a little bit to discuss.
There's a little bit, isn't there?
There's a nice happy surprise in this when I was conducting roll call, which I had to actually tell Mand about. And I had to rush in and I went, I don't normally do this, but I've just found out it's this guy. So there we go. Ready? Here we go. Who hasn't introduced roll call? I think everyone has. Everyone introduced.
Can we do it in pidgin English, or is that considered racially offensive? If we do it?
I don't. There you go.
That'll do. Roll call. Right. Well, where do we go from here? As Nick Haywood would say. Start with Ralph. Ask.
Right.
Oh. Okay.
Ralph Macchio.
Yeah.
Has he been in anything else other than Karate Kid?
Oh, if only we had a segment on the show where we discussed other things that he's been in. That's a really good idea. That's a brilliant idea. In fact, let's start now.
Go on, then.
Okay. Ralph Macchio. Anyone? No, do you know what? It's the list is so short, we might actually, like Family Fortunes, or as you say, Joe, Family Feud, we might actually get all of the main films he's in. Not the chaff. There's loads of chaff, but let's go. Come on.
Well, I clearly don't know, so.
Well, you could take Karate Kid Part 1. You have 1, 2, and 3. Yeah.
He was in My Cousin Vinny.
He was.
That's all I can think of.
Well, see, I remember him from a film where he starred against
the devil.
And Steve Vai, and it was like the devil came down to
Crossroads.
Crossroads, yeah. Crossroads is a good film.
And The Outsiders. I just watched that recently. He was in that.
Oh, I didn't pick that up. Oh, I should have done. That's a great film. But not obviously because of him, because it wasn't very memorable. And then a familiar pattern in this. He's also in Cobra Kai.
Yeah, but that's not a film.
Apart from one. Yeah, but it's things he's been in.
And that's kind of related to Karate Kid anyway.
Well, that's it. That's it for Ralph Macchio. I don't have anything else.
Don, so do you think his...
I thought Don might have something. Wait a minute.
I mean, he did appear in bits and pieces, didn't he? But I think this film really typecast him, didn't it? Really, unfortunately.
Yeah.
A load of six-sides. You know, famously playing a character much younger than his actual age. And after that, yeah, he was pretty much typecast.
Like,
yeah.
Daniel Radcliffe. That's it.
Radcliffe's probably got enough money to be able to kind of buy his way into other films, hasn't he? But I don't think Ralph made as much off the back of this, did he, unfortunately?
Daniel Radcliffe's got into more live acting, hasn't he? He's more on the stage.
He's gotten into mostly direct-to-video movies. You know, after Harry Potter, he really hasn't done much. I mean, he's done a lot, but he hasn't done much good, I would say.
Probably shouldn't bite the hand that feeds him, hey Joe, but still,
yeah,
mind.
True. Yeah.
Well, I would agree with that, yeah.
Consequences and all that. So before we delve down, if we go down that, the Google's algorithm's going to go, wee, it's just going to spike, and then we're going to be taken off. I was about to say taken off air. We're not. It's all pre-recorded. You can pretend it's live if you want, but no, it's all pre-recorded. Pat Morita, Mr. Miyagi. Joe. Where did he first appear before The Karate Kid?
And I know, I can tell you.
And lay it on me, Joe.
Happy Days.
Yep. Happy Days.
He played Arnold. The hangout that they used to go to, the diner, was called Arnold's. He was Arnold.
I thought that was an older, bigger American guy.
He eventually left. That was Al. Almo Mullerant. I can't think. Pronounce his name. Malinar. I can't think of his name.
He's great. Get it.
Got a big nose and you know. Yeah, no, but the early, I would say the first 3 to 5 seasons, it was Pat Morita was Arnold. And he was very funny. And I had a very difficult time with the Karate Kid because I was so used to him as Arnold and he was just a comedian. So I knew he wasn't a karate master, you know. He was, you know how like when you see somebody in a movie and you're so used to them being a certain character, it took me a while to forget that he was Arnold from Happy Days.
Wow. How the Mighty Fallen. He was in all the Karate Kid films, 1, 2, 3, and the next Karate Kid, which we'll get to. We'll get to what happens in the other ones towards the end. However, Dom, this one's for you. He played waiter in restaurant in Spy Hard, the Leslie Nielsen James Bond spoof.
That's kind of sad, though, isn't it, really?
It is, really. Yeah. It was the voice of the Emperor in Mulan, in Disney's Mulan. And he was in four episodes of Baywatch.
Four episodes of Baywatch. Sounds you can hear audiences, the bottom of the barrel being well and truly scraped.
But he died 3 years after appearing in Baywatch. So he died in 2005. So do you know what? It's a nice way to go, isn't it, I suppose? Being in Baywatch for four episodes.
I thought you were going to say the kidney and urinary tract infection, which I see is what he actually died of on Wikipedia. That doesn't sound marvellous, to be honest. But look, this is my slot here, because he was, of course, famously Oscar nominated for the first Karate Kid film as Best Supporting Actor.
Really? Was he?
Yeah, I didn't know that.
I thought famously, yeah. It was because obviously we had to talk about the sequel, but the original film was, and Joe, maybe you can back me up here, it was kind of a bit of a breakthrough for Asian actors in the US and kind of representing Japanese culture in mainstream Hollywood cinema. And the Oscars committee, or the Academy Awards committee, obviously doubled down on that and gave him a nomination in 1984 for Best Supporting Actor. So he didn't win, sadly, and probably justifiably. But here's the other ones. So
who did win?
Well, yeah, I'm going to give you the five nominees and let's see who we think might have won. So no particular order. So Ralph Richardson for the Greystoke, The Legend of Tarzan. Pat Morita for The Karate Kid. John Malkovich for Places in the Heart. Adolf Caesar for A Soldier's Story. Or Hang S. Gore for The Killing Fields.
Killing Fields.
Yeah, I would have said that.
I would say Greystoke.
Well, that was posthumous for Ralph Richardson, but could have tugged on the heartstrings, but no, it was indeed The Killing Fields. So that's two kind of Asian American actors nominated the same year, and sadly, Mr. Miyagi lost out. But yeah, I think it's one of those you wouldn't get a nomination for that sort of film and that sort of performance these days. But who's to say whether that's right or wrong?
Yeah. Well. That's him. So, yeah, this is why it's going to be quite short.
From that to Baywatch.
From that to Martin Cove, Grease. He's in it, and Karate Kid 3 is all about his revenge story. So that's why he's the reference is there. He's the
sensei of the other American
of Cobra Kai. Yeah.
Group. Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. The one that was really horrible to the guy that lost in his group.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Where I first knew him from, because we were big fans in the Hunter households, watching Cagney and Lacey. So he was one of the other detectives. Really? Yeah, yeah. He also starred in Wyatt Earp, the Kevin Costner film. But most of these people that I'm about to read out, thank their lucky stars that somebody went, what happens if we went and revisited everybody in the Karate Kid films? What's Daniel doing now? What's Johnny doing now? I don't know. Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't we make a series? YouTube, it was a YouTube original series first. So if you were a subscriber, a premium subscriber of YouTube, you got the whole of this thing. And I went, wonderful, wonderful. You know, great. It's going to pull on it. There was a rematch between the older Johnny and Daniel. You're like, loving this. But Martin Cove, getting back to it, he then stars in Cagney and Lacey, The Return, because it was all about making films. So they had the Bionic Woman showdown, the Bionic Man, or the Bionic People, or whatever it was called, showdown. So had the Bionic Woman and the Bionic Man with a Sandra Bullock in her first ever film in the 80s, where she stars in this made-for-TV movie because they just want to bring the characters back. They did the same for Cagney and Lacey, The Return. Spoiler alert, it was awful. But they always are. They're never good. They're good for 5 minutes. You see the characters and then go, not interested. Then what did he do? Straight to video stuff. He starred in such highlights as Crocodile 2 Death Swamp, The Sting of the Black Scorpion.
Well, they're not very good famous movies, are they?
And Chinaman's Chance, America's Other Slaves. He starred in The Goldbergs, because I'm starting to watch The Goldbergs, and there was an episode about the Karate Kid, and he starred as Master John in there, so he didn't reprise his role.
But I think you're missing one big one.
Go on. Oh, sorry, First Blood Part 2. Sorry, yeah.
Yeah,
you're right, that. Yeah, yeah. Which he's good. He is good in that. But he's got one of those faces where you go, yeah, I think he's done a lot more. And I think it's just because he pops up, like in Miami Vice. Everybody in the 80s pops up in Miami Vice. Everyone,
he's got one of those faces that you want to punch.
Well, yes, maybe. Anyway, Cobra Kai comes along and goes, would you like a nice big check to reap? Yes, 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 I would. I'm not even going to hesitate on that.
So is Cobra Kai any good?
Yes, so I'm the only one on here that's watched it. So I've watched the first season and half of the second season. And yeah, now that I've watched this, yes, it's better. It's better than this film. It's obviously brought up to date. The characters are brought in, but not in a way that goes, we're just going to bring them in, bang, and just because you're going to love them. So doesn't suffer from the thing that I just said, where you bring the characters back just for a reunion. It doesn't suffer like that. There's actually a story behind it. Daniel now sells BMWs and Audis. Johnny's down on his luck. He hasn't got anything, really, until he decides to start up the Cobra Kai gym again and get some of the local teens in that have been bullied. And it turns out that he, in the first season, Daniel is the bad guy. And Johnny's the good guy because he's the one helping the kids that have been bullied, one of which is Daniel's kid doing the bullying. Yeah. So yeah, it turns it a little bit on its head in quite a good way as well, I would say. But here's my little surprise, he says, moving on. Yuji Okamoto, and I know I've just said terrible, the worst thing in this film. Can't act. Obviously, he said he makes a good guy. But Joe, I'm going to direct this one at you. Truly an awesome sight.
No way. Was that him?
That's him.
Get the hell out of here.
That's him.
That is a huge shock.
That's him.
Oh my God.
What? And I wouldn't mind, but when we did Better Off Dead, sorry, Dom's sitting here looking, for those that can see, it's looking perplexed and going, what? Probably Amanda's, even though she watched the film with me, but...
Oh, I know who you mean.
I know, because we discussed it this morning. Yeah, so he's the guy that's at the lights with John Cusack every time John Cusack draws up. There he is, but in reality, it's not his voice. So, Joe, there's a big complicated story why that's not him that says that. But do you know what?
I'm going to have to watch that again now.
Yeah.
I mean, both movies. Well, part of this movie.
Yeah, Better Off Dead is just wonderful. But again, he didn't do an awful lot. He went and started such classics as Brain Smasher, A Love Story. I don't know. I think if you're going to smash the brain.
Then... these titles.
But he's one of those people that pops up in things. The Michael Douglas, Sean Penn thing, The Game. He stars in The Truman Show. Admittedly, his entry on IMDb was Chinese family or member of Chinese family. I'm like, okay. He's also Inception. And again, he's one of the other ones that went, check please, when it came to Cobra Kai, because he ends up in season 3. I'm not going to spoil it. We're just going to, watch it.
Have you seen season 3 or not?
No. I'm halfway through.
I don't know if he's got any better at acting.
Well, I would hope so, because he's been in some good, decent films since then. So perhaps. Sato, Danny. Oh, I haven't written it down. Derry Caracona. Sato, he died in 1996. He was successful in a TV series called Burke's Law. He was in LA Law. He was in Miami Vice. Who wasn't? And also in a film called Black Widow with Deborah Winger and Teresa Russell. So for those people, it's the first time we mentioned Teresa Russell on 80s podcast, but I say it in the same vein as Rebecca De Mornay. Teresa Russell was very good looking. Even Joe's drawing a blank on that one.
You mean Terry Russell?
Teresa Russell.
Okay, yeah, there's a blank.
Okay. And lastly, Tamlin Tomita, who played Kimiko. She was in 24, The Day After Tomorrow. She plays a climate scientist in Day After Tomorrow. She was in Heroes, quite had a good big role in The Good Doctor. Also in season 3 of Picard. And again, check please, because then she goes into season 4 of Cobra Kai.
Well, no, I definitely want to see that then.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
So is she the girl or is she the older lady?
Older.
No, she's the girl.
Yes,
Kimiko is the younger girl.
Right, okay.
Miyagi's love.
Yeah. Aww.
So just to finish this off, and please, by all means, chip in if you've got anything. But Karate Kid 3 is the revenge story of Kreese, in which he gets his mate to help him. Rebuilds Cobra Kai. Daniel says to Mr. Miyagi, can you help me train to defend my title? And he goes, no. So the bad guy, who's pretending to be his friend, trains him and basically injures him all the time. Gets him to do things that break his break stuff on him. It's a very odd film. The next Karate Kid, Miyagi is the only person in that. He travels to Boston to commemorate Asian Americans in the war. Meets his old commanding officer and has got a granddaughter who's unruly. And I've not seen it. Joe, I think you might be the only one that's seen it. Maybe have you seen
it? I thought it was okay. Who was the girl in that?
Doesn't say.
She went on to win 2 Oscars.
Okay. From the next Karate Kid in 94.
Yeah, it was crazy. It was she was in that Clint Eastwood movie about, you know, the girl boxer. She won an Oscar for that, and then she won an Oscar for something else too.
Hillary Swank,
yeah.
Right, okay.
That was Hillary Swank.
I didn't even look it up. That's a good shout.
Yeah, I mean, when you look at that, you know, you're like, she's not going to do anything. And then, boom, she just exploded after that. I mean, it wasn't because of that movie. It's just that she happened to get into the right movies.
Mm. What was it, Million Dollar Baby?
That was her breakthrough film, wasn't it? Karate Kid 4, or Next Karate.
Yeah.
Was it?
Yeah.
That's a good... See, I like finding stuff like that. I didn't know. The Karate Kid remake in 2010 with Jaden Smith, Will Smith's kid. No Mr. Miyagi, it's Mr. Han. And it's universally rejected. Nobody liked it. I don't know anyone that liked it.
Plus, he was teaching him Kung Fu.
Yeah. It's just...
Jaden Smith
was called the Kung Fu kid.
Say that again.
I said, so Jaden Smith's such a likable actor as well. I can't believe nobody, nobody went for that. Yeah.
So he was called the Kung Fu Kid.
Jackie Chan is Chinese and he knows Kung Fu. And Pat Morita's Japanese and apparently he knows karate. You know, it's a weird cultural thing that they just, for some reason, they didn't want to change the name because people would maybe not go see it, but if they saw Karate Kid and it was a remake, they're like, well, we'll get a lot of people in to buy tickets. But yeah, it made no sense. I never seen it because just wasn't interested in it. No, I don't like remakes.
2024, they're making another film. A sequel with all of the people that are in Cobra Kai, but it's not connected to Cobra Kai.
So what's it going to be then?
I have no idea.
Karate Kid 5? Who's not a kid anymore?
Well, this isn't going to spoil Cobra Kai for you. Right, well, don't know, but it's not going to spoil Cobra Kai for you. But here's where all their paychecks went. So I'm just picking out the major characters. Season 1, you get Johnny and Daniel back, and Daniel's mum comes back.
Jeez.
Season 2, you get Tommy, Jimmy, and Kreese. So Tommy and Jimmy are the people that are at the side going, yeah, at the Hill Valley tournament. They're members of Cobra Kai. So they come back. Season 3, you get Elizabeth Shue back as the original girlfriend in Karate Kid Part 1. You get Bobby. Bobby is billed as the guy, you know, when they're all dressed as in Karate Kid 1, they're all dressed as the skeletons.
Yeah.
And they're about to beat the heck out of Daniel. He's the one that went, "Hey, he's had enough, man. He's had enough." And Johnny goes, "I'll decide when he's had enough." Right? He's called in what I do, the conscience of Cobra Kai. So Bobby comes back. Kimiko comes back and Chosen comes back in season 3. Season 4, they bring in the bad guy from Karate Kid 3. So Terry Silver comes back. And season 5, you get the girlfriend from Karate Kid 3 comes back. And I'm like, just pack it. Just pack it full as many as you want because I'm in. I'm happy.
Well, anyway. That's what a lot of these like reboots, they try to do that, the whole member Barry thing where they bring in like all these characters that, you know, but it sounds like it's a decent story, but most of the times they're not decent stories and they just like, we'll say, well, like we bring back and we see what this character looks like now, people might want to tune into it. Mm. But yeah. I am looking forward to seeing it.
Was Karate Kid actually like a really big movie in terms of, you know, turnover and popularity?
Massive. Dom, why do you got the computer up to see what the turnover was?
Because
it was pretty big over here.
To be able to have all this sort of spin-off and to actually get to like season 5 on a spin-off, you know, much later, there must be some traction. There must be some, you know, desire to watch that.
It made $130 million off an $8 million budget. So, you know, profitability was through the roof. But I think if you were like to brainstorm 80s films, Hollywood 80s films, it wouldn't be in your first tier along with your Back to the Futures and, you know, Ferris Bueller perhaps. But I reckon it'd be in that quite near the top of that second tier of films, you know, Karate Kid. It was definitely one that was, in Britain at least, made the playgrounds. You know, it was one of the things, have you seen that film, trying to create various kicks and things, you know, ignoring all the advisory warnings about not doing this at home and kids getting roundhoused and nunchucked on the way to hospital.
I think what they've done, they've been quite clever. They've targeted our age bracket with it.
Yeah.
Because in 1986, I was 12. So I would have been...
But you didn't go to cinema much,
no,
did you?
I didn't. But, you know, just talking around this, this is the age group, you know, 12 to 15s, where you'd be going to watch this film, wouldn't you? So now we're all kind of late 40s, early 50s. We're the ideal target audience to sit and binge watch Cobra Kai, I guess.
Yeah, and I think it's smart because it's probably like, that age group now has kids and they're introducing the kids to the Karate Kid, you know, and it's just continuing to grow the audience, like where, because I know kids are into it too. So I think it was a smart move.
Yeah.
Especially like you said, if it's got 5 seasons, they're not renewing it if it's unsuccessful. So I guess it's doing good in the ratings.
Yeah. For good reason in that sense. Dom, I'm going to have to take issues. The crane kick at the Hill Valley tournament is in maybe top 10 moments of the 80s. It's just brilliant, which is why it keeps calling back to it. Yeah.
you've got Back to the Future being pulled along by a car on a skateboard, also resulting in hospitalizations for a number of children. I would say that was an iconic moment, but, you know, perhaps in terms of iconic films, just in that second tier, I would say.
Yeah. And while we're on the crane kick, we're about to go talk about the film now, but while we're on the crane kick, he even says at the start of this, when they're doing the recap, if crane kick, I was about to impersonate him. No, if the crane kick is done properly, there is no defense. Well, clearly there is.
There is.
Spoiler alert. It turns out all you need to do is just put your hand in front of his leg. So, yeah.
I was going to ask you, are you going to talk about the Rocky connection?
Do you know what? I was going to talk about it when we came to trivia time, but let's introduce it now.
Okay.
Because I think this is going to blow, I know it, but I think it might blow Dom and
Mavis
minds. Well, here you go.
Well, as we're doing trivia time then.
Trivia time!
Right. And that was the moment we got taken off air.
So the director, what was it, Alvinson?
John Alvinson.
Yeah, that directed Rocky, the first Rocky movie. So he went on to direct Rocky, I'm sorry, The Karate Kid Part Two, and also Bill Conti that does the music for most of the Rocky movies. Like, well, the first two, at least. Is the first two or three? Maybe three,
three. Three.
Yeah. Yeah, he didn't do Rocky IV. He ended up doing Karate Kid, which was kind of good in a way, you know, because I like Rocky IV's music. It's a little different. But no, it's just, and it is a Rocky movie. I mean, let's face it. He's an underdog. He needs to be trained. And then, you know, at the end, not that Rocky was successful at the end, but, you know, he went the distance. It's, again, they know the formula. Audiences like underdogs. They like to see, you know, them get bullied in the beginning and then just kind of at the end become the hero. And they've done that formula, I think, with every Karate Kid movie that they've had. And it seems to work.
Mm. But, and with that Rocky connection, the film starts with Daniel in the shower after the tournament. And of course, Rocky V starts with Rocky in the shower after the fight with Drago.
What I thought was funny is like, what was that guy from Chicago that you like that does the song?
From Chicago? Power of, Chicago, the band. Sorry.
The band Chicago.
I was thinking, who do I know in Chicago? Peter Cetera.
Yeah, Peter Cetera. Yeah. So he did the, is it The Glory of Love?
Glory of Love, yeah. It's a great song.
So he wrote that for...
Was was it?
Yeah.
Right.
That's the original song. Didn't win, but yeah.
Oh, so wow. he wrote that for Rocky IV. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go on.
I didn't get that far in my research. Carry on, Joe.
Okay.
No, he wrote that for Rocky IV, which I kind of thought was funny, and Stallone rejected it. I could just see him like say, it's like, hey, yo, that ain't no riot of Tiger, you know? Because I can't see him, you know, training to that song.
The song that came out of Rocky IV? There wasn't one.
Well, there was
Burning on Fire. Heart.
Hearts on Fire.
Well, Hearts on Fire never made the charts, so.
Even so. That,
but it's I not. I mean,
the Glory of
like,
Love would
Glory
not
of Love
work.
Was number one in multiple countries.
Do you seriously think that would work in a Rocky movie?
It'd be better than No Easy Way Out, but yeah.
I disagree. Anyway. Yeah, because it's so soft, that song. I don't know. Anyway,
let's get into the film. Let's get into the film because we'll be here all day.
That's true.
So what did we think of how the film started? The recap, the start of the film until you get to the 6 months later, and you know what do we think? What do you think? I'm going to take a drink, so I'm going to listen to you.
Strong start, I thought. I quite like the recap and the bit we just discussed where it picks up in the showers and then there's that confrontation in the car park, and I you know, it connected it with the previous film, and actually, you know, represented a bit of a peak of interest before a subsequent drop off. So yeah, I like that. people recreating their role. It reminded me that they were better baddies in the first film than in the second, I think.
Yeah, I was very enthusiastic when I saw the beginning of the film because it really got you into it, and it was a nice recap, and more films should do that because it's like, it's almost like you don't have to see the first movie if you didn't want to. They're basically showing you what happened, you know, why it led him to this, what his relationship is with, what Daniel-san's relationship is with Miyagi. It was very well done. It was very well edited, I thought.
Mm. Amanda, do you want me to tell everyone what happened when you watched the start of this?
Sorry, I have to keep going on mute because the washing machine's just finished its spin.
Oh, okay. the joys of production.
I think it's finally shut up now. Yeah. Yeah. But I was.
What you say?
I was a bit confused at the start because I thought, I've seen that.
I'm like, so, is this called a recap, sweetheart?
Yes. Well, I didn't realise, did I?
What, you thought this film's moving on a bit? It's a...
I know, I said it's a bit jumpy. Is this like from the first movie? Yes, you said. Yes, it is, Amanda. Right.
Probably a tad more forceful than that, but yes.
Oh, yeah, but the panpipe soon got on my nerves.
Well, yeah, I mean, I mean, I'm not being funny. Even at 14, if you don't realise that the "I could kill you, but honk" bit is going to make an appearance later in the film, then you have no business watching films, because there's a reason why that's just happened.
That was a cool scene, though.
Oh, it was when I was 14. It's not now. It's embarrassing now.
Well, yeah, the honk thing, yeah, is embarrassing. But, you know, just, you know, what's his name? Reese or...
Reese.
Yeah. You know, just him attacking Miyagi and Miyagi going out of the way of his blows and all that, like crippling his hands. That was a cool little scene. I thought, yeah, but no, I understand.
Yeah, yeah, saying. I like that scene. Yeah, yeah.
The honk thing is just... Both times is just disastrous.
You get tricked into punching a car windscreen once. You know, shame on me. You do it twice. Yeah. I mean, the bloke then probably bleeds to death on the tarmac if it's any bearing on reality, as he's lacerated his wrists. But yeah, I thought they could have come up with a more original idea for the second example.
Okay, he says, "Mercy is for the weak."
I wonder if he's going to go for a headbutt on the third one, and then yet again stick it through a car window. And that
actually, but you know, I think it would have been cooler if he would have said, "I could end your life right now, your pain, but I won't." You know, instead it's honk. You know,
yeah.
But again, it was for the kids, and I guess if you were a kid watching that, you might have laughed in the theater.
Jar Jar Binks was for the kids as well, Joe. It doesn't work. You know, it doesn't always work.
You say for the kids, yeah, he honks his nose as if, oh, he's got off lightly. But in reality, the guy's got shards of glass sticking out of his arms. He must have lost 2 pints of blood in that episode. So, you know, I'm not sure it's quite the gentle payoff that the director intended, really.
Oh, but anyway, so from there, said like SpongeBob, 6 months later.
That's where the drowsiness kicked, that's where the film spiked my drink with kicked in at that point, because he went on his gentle tour of Japan and Shinto temples and
Before he does that, by the way, he says, "Oh, I've just split up with Elizabeth Shue because she totaled my car," and I'm not going to spoil it for you, but she tells the real story when she gets to Cobra Kai that Daniel. Well, I won't spoil it for you. But anyway, there was a miscommunication. So he splits up. It, by the way, he split up from Kimiko at the start of Karate Kid Part 3.
Yeah, he's a loser.
You know why? Yes. Because I watched it. I had to watch it just before we recorded the podcast. I thought, well, I'll just have a quick look at the start of 3. Turns out that she says she got offered a dance opportunity in Tokyo.
Okay.
But never she never even came back with him.
Wouldn't she go to Bone Dance Academy?
What?
Well, that was the thing that she kept doing through the whole movie. She's like, "My dream is to become professional bone dancer."
I missed that.
Okay. Well, that's all she was doing throughout the whole movie.
She was doing loads of stuff with fans and things.
Yeah, those are that's called a bone dance.
What, it's not called a fan dance?
No, she kept saying over and over it was bone dance.
So if you dance with dogs, then you call it a cat dance.
Well, wherever they lived, that's what they called it. You know, their section of Japan, well, I guess it was Okinawa or whatever, you know, it was called bone dance. It's, you know, I'm surprised you missed that, because the word bone dance must have been mentioned at least, I would say, 15 to 20 times.
Did you pick that up?
No, I didn't pick that up.
Yeah. Oh, I did, because me and my friend, we saw it in the theaters and we
did. You watch the special edition? Oh, I bet you, yeah, I bet you left.
No, because she kept like saying like how important bone dance was to me. You know, it's like, geez, you need to get a life, lady.
Yeah, second baby to the tea ceremonies.
don't be mean about it.
No, we've got to be mean. It's fine. That's coming.
Japanese culture, the tea ceremony must be the least favorite bit. Just have a brew. Yeah, put the kettle on, have a brew. Job done. 5 minutes. Yeah, this country was founded on having a cup of tea, not poncing around taking hours over it. Yeah, my goodness me.
It's got to be moved 3 times.
In between all the bone dances and the tea ceremonies, it's no wonder the village has achieved nothing in Miyagi's absence, is it really? Oh, that guy's still sitting where he was 40 years ago playing the guitar. Yeah, because he's wasted his life dicking around with the tea ceremonies. Get on with it. Where's your sense of entrepreneurialism? Oh, grief. No wonder they'd be walked all over by that bad guy. Laziness, if you ask me.
Oh, okay. I was going to say that it's just a, and I know it's a different film, but there's a reason for this. At the start of Karate Kid 3, when they come off the plane, Daniel's apartment block where his mum lived has been demolished. Right? No. And his mum's disappeared. And eventually his mum rings.
She's gone to Fresno, isn't she?
What's that?
She's gone to Fresno.
No, she's not in Fresno. What? The apartment block's been demolished.
In Fresno.
So the one from the first one has been demolished. It turns out that his mum rings him at Miyagi's house and says, I'm here with your Uncle Alan, who's got emphysema. And if you want to see one of the, possibly the worst acting ever, look at Uncle Alan in the background, who's got a big bell on his hospital, on his like hospital bed. And he's trying to mimic having problems. Now you won't be able to see this if you're not on YouTube, but he's basically jerking like if you were playing after 10 pints, if you were playing charades and you were trying to mimic someone having some sort of medical episode, that would be him. It's that bad. And he picks up this bell and jingles it in her ear, and I'm like,
I think I remember that.
Oh, what is going on? Let's come back to this. So the reason why I mentioned that is because what is going on with his parenting? I know his dad died and that's very sad, but his mom is quite happy with I don't think they've ever met apart from the fact that he used to be the janitor in the bar in the apartment block which got knocked down. He used to be the janitor. That's all she knows him from, and she's entrusted her kid. Yeah, she's entrusted her kid. This kid hangs around with the creepy Japanese guy that's got all the cars. Nobody's batting an eyelid.
But in real life, you were packed off up north for multiple weeks in the summer.
That was an oddity rather than a norm. Yeah, but nobody's done that.
To go and see your sister's ex-boyfriend.
What's this story?
Oh, God, right.
That's bizarre.
Right, very quickly. My sister used to go out with a guy called Gary. They split up, but Gary went to university in Newcastle-upon-Tyne. So my parents thought it'd be a good idea to pitch me up to go and stay with him so they didn't have to pay for any clubs or look after me over summer. Yes, get the violins out if you want to. So what they did is they went, would you like to go up and stay in the student house with Gary and the three other people that are in there? They put 300 quid, a lot of money by that time, in my back pocket, put me on a train and said, Gary, I'll pick you up at the other end.
Mental.
And I was 13.
13.
Yeah, and when I got there, I lived in the student house, and I saw horror for the first time. I saw porn for the first time.
Oh, jeez.
They used to send me out because I was tall. They used to send me out to the video shop and go and get us 7 videos we can all watch. And my 300 quid basically subsidized this, but I think I got an education out of it because I like to listen to a lot of vinyl. One of them had a compact disc player for the first time. I'm like, oh my God, this is the best thing ever. And to finish this particular story, they all wanted to go out fairly early on in the summer. And so they took me out and I went up to a pub. I can tell you where it was. It was in Heaton in Newcastle. And I went and ordered 6 bottles of Newcastle Brown. And it was the first time I went to a bar and ordered myself at 30, just past 13. So I'd just been 13.
Well, you had 6? You had 6 that
night?
No,
I was ordering for then.
Oh, okay.
He was their skiffy.
I was the skiffy. And then from there, we went into the city and I went to my first nightclub and I got chatted up by an extremely attractive, presumably 20, 21-year-old. And meanwhile, I'm at 13. And just because I'm tall, the guy just waved me in. And I'm sat there going, what do I do? This isn't the school disco. This is, I've got a drink. I've got.
Yeah, there's so many things I want to say that I can't say.
I know. Well,
you see what I mean, though? And you're saying that Miyagi.
I did it for 2 more summers. So, you know, with the question, when you say, have you watched all these films? Have you got all these films? Because all we did was just watch films over the summer and go out and get drunk.
At 14, maybe Ralph Macchio's mother was relaxed about sending him off because she knew that he was secretly 42 or however old he actually was when he appeared in this film, which is the key difference between Sweet and Innocent Charlie Hunter at 13 and Ralph Macchio being in his early 40s and married at this stage, I think. Maybe not quite that bad, but he was well into his 20s, wasn't he?
Absolutely. He's probably got another ulterior motive. Oh, yeah, he was much older at that time.
Oh!
Yeah. But I think he got him over and went, yeah, so I'm building this house. I'm building this annex bit. Oh, who's it for? Oh, it's for you, Daniel. All right, okay. Well, who's going to build it? I haven't got to that bit. No, wait a minute. I've got it. If you focus, you can put this nail in with a hammer.
In one go.
And he goes, this is great. And he starts picking up nails. He goes back, probably kicks back with a beer and go, happy days. I have to pay the workmen to come in. I just tell him the whole thing needs to be zen-like focused. And it needs to be built by somebody who cherishes the rose blossoms. And he's going, yeah, sold that. Nice. I'm out.
Look how happy he was when he got the nail in, though. He had this like look of, it was like a kid at Christmas. He couldn't believe it. He just kept doing it. Yeah, but as you say, Miyagi kicks back. Job well done.
You can tell just by his voice that Daniel's not too bright, you know? He's probably had struggle getting along through life, so it's kind of lucky that he ended up at Mr. Miyagi, even if he had to do some manual labor for him.
Yeah, when he's on that plane, he's got a History of Okinawa book, hasn't he? And it's clearly the first book he's ever read in his life. It's, you know, this is a big thing for him. He's got a book.
I'm surprised that wasn't, book on tape, because I can't picture him reading.
It's full of pictures. I think that's the secret.
Where's this picture me, Mr. Miyagi?
Oh, you're just being cruel.
Well, again, wait a minute. Bad parenting. How does he get the money out to afford the plane ticket? It's his college fund, so I assume it's locked away. So he can't do it overnight. Anyway, let's just say that he can. He rings his mum up and goes, you know that old guy?
He's going to Japan.
He's built an annex for me and he's invited me to Japan. Good luck, son.
That sounds fine. Okay, you can go.
Come on, Charlie, come on.
Oh, I can't. That's good. Yeah, anyway, so can I go to Japan with the old guy? Yes.
The caretaker.
It's like, well, what are you going to do there? It's like, oh, we're going to watch some videos.
No. No, she's got to ask, why are you going? Well, there's a feud. I'm going to go straight to this boiling pot.
His dad's not well.
No, his dad's not well, but equally, say there's a feud where basically... So somebody wants to kill the caretaker. And she still says yes.
I'm just going to withdraw my college fund before I go, Mum. That's fine. Enjoy your wild goose chase, son. Try not to get kidnapped.
You know, he could have said, he goes, well, if I don't go with Mr. Miyagi, I'm going to be left alone in this little annex.
That I'm building. Anyway, they get over there. Is there anything? Do we want to? Anything?
Oh,
on the
I
plane?
Noticed there was a lot of leg room on the plane.
Yes. Yeah. So,
a lot of leg room. And there was no one smoking.
Oh, smoking on planes, yes. I see. Well, at least suddenly Daniel, I think Daniel tells him on, which probably is the information that he could have given his mum. He said, we've got to fight for the honour. Oh, and Peter Satir is sat going, I wonder how I'm going to finish this. Oh, I'm a man that's going to fight for your honour? Yeah, sounds good. Great. They say, I'm going to fight to the death. At this point, Danny should be, so there's a 50% chance I could come home on my own.
It's like, is he allowed?
Did you want to tell me?
A parent.
Well, as Dom says, he's 36 or whatever, or however old he was.
But he get to finish the rest of the book on the way home.
through his tears of why did I do all that? And I'm sorry, can we fast forward? Miyagi, he wins. Well, Miyagi doesn't win it. He just makes the bet. He puts the collateral down. wins back the college money when Daniel breaks the ice. Mm. So what does Daniel do with the college money? Takes it out with him when he knows there's a guy that's going to be beating him up all the time.
He takes the whole lot out.
The whole wadge.
How would you do that?
Like, what?
Even if you lost your wallet, you wouldn't take the whole lot out. You'd only take out what you need for the night, surely.
Yeah. And if you look at the airport scene, Sato has a karate academy. He also has a construction firm, as we see. But if you look in the top corner, he also does escort services as well. And you're like, well, that's cool. quite a varied portfolio, should we say.
He's also got commercial fishing.
Oh, of course,
He's like the Donald Trump of that area.
Oh, can you? And I don't know, we're fast forwarding over there. The cannery that's built by the village that took the fish away, or they try to explain the reason why nobody fishes anymore is because of that big cannery thing.
It's the commercial fishing, yeah.
Right. And Sato built that, yeah?
Yeah. Got rid of all the local fishes.
Yeah. At 18, because Miyagi went, I had my first date here with this girl when I was 18.
Yeah.
And I'm like, so Sato at 14 decides to go, do you know what? I'm going to go into the cannery business. He can't have built it by then. Roughly the same age, I think. So he can't have had his first date in something that hadn't been built.
I thought the cannery was less mysterious than the American Air Force base, which is referenced really firmly early on. And then like just basically appears in the background with helicopters flying around every so often. Why on earth would you introduce that and then have no real relation to that in the rest of the film? You know, surely there was an opportunity for some jeeps or some tanks or some helicopters or something, but it just happens to be there.
Yeah, that I found that a bit weird. I didn't know if there was anything going on with Sato and sort of like some underhanded deeds or whatever. Or
there were so many missed opportunities in this film. Like, for example, when they land in Japan eventually and they get taken to that airport hangar, there's a confrontation. All that happens is he gets his book and chucks it at him. You know, that could have been that was your first opportunity for a bit of karate, I think, a bit of a punch up, and opportunity missed consistently all the way through the film.
They just get a taxi.
It was Sato's airfield. Did you notice that?
Yeah.
does he own the taxi?
Anyway. Yeah, I mean, I never understood. Why didn't Mr. Miyagi just beat the crap out of those guys that were driving the cab or the limo?
And Sato at the same time and go, do you know what, mofo, let's get this over with. Right, boom, bang, done. Right, I'm off to see my dad. If you come anywhere near the village, you'll get a bit more.
I kill you after dad die.
There'd have been no film.
Oh, and that would that been such a bad thing?
Well, there is basically nothing really that happens between that bit when they land in Japan. You could just fast forward it to the final confrontation scene at the end and not miss out on a great deal, because all it is a lot of posturing about a fight which keeps on getting delayed for various reasons, and an extra 3 days checked in here and there for,
And they just keep turning up. Hi, I'm here. What are you going to do? Are you going to fight? No. Oh, we're going to rough up some of you greens. Right, okay. Hi, it's us again. Are you going to fight? No. Right, we're going to rough up some of your greens again. I'm like, why don't you just get on a plane? Why don't you just get on a plane? As Daniel said, let's just get out of here. And
they should have just taken the girl and, like, Miyagi's love and just gone.
Well, I thought at one stage they were going to start turning and speaking directly to the camera, and they might as well just be talking to the audience about what was going on and what they were seeing at one point. When tragically the father dies and they release the candles onto the river, I just, my notes were saying, what is this, the point where people start walking out the film in America when it was shown? Come in and watch an action film and some reverential and panpipes. That's when I made my note about panpipes, just because panpipes are played doesn't mean that it has meaning, really, does it? It's, you've got to do better than that. The panpipes must be the worst musical instrument, bar none.
Bagpipes. South American, anyway.
Yeah, I agree with you. I thought that was South American.
They're not native to Japan.
No.
I don't. You're introduced at this point that the drum is the secret to Miyagi's. And I'm like, dude, you just trained him for a major tournament. Why don't you tell him about the drum? Especially if this underpins your entire family karate secret. Why don't you just tell him?
that was much less successful than Wax On, Wax Off, I thought. That kid's rattle was not fooling anybody as being a way of secretly learning karate, really. You know, Wax On, Wax Off, that was brilliant.
So, this was my question is, like, if everyone in that village had that drum, doesn't that mean that they know karate and that they know that form of karate? So why do, like, when their village is being attacked and they're taking away their vegetables or destroying it, why don't they fight back? Why do you learn karate and you don't use it? It's just,
it's in self-defense.
Well, they should be defending vegetables.
But Dom should advise you just start windmilling. I mean, at the very least, you take two of them out.
Exactly. Yeah, head down, windmilling. That's it. Try and pull someone's t-shirt over their head. You know, they should have done the Karate Kid when it comes to Britain. And they have like a punch up in a boot and a Wetherspoons. Let's see how far your kid's rattle gets you in one of those fights when somebody's got a sawn off pool cue coming at your head. Karate Kid 6, the Newcastle years. Yeah, there's a young Charles Hunter in the background looking unscared.
Oh, well, I couldn't put that better myself. I do like the fact that Sato likes the village that much that he decimated the fishing industry there. I mean, he was responsible for taking away the thing that had the pleasure. You talked about the guy doing playing the guitar in exactly the same place. They've taken away. What do they do apart from listen to these helicopters go back and forth from the airbase?
Grow vegetables, by the looks of things. Yeah. But, right, I was a bit confused.
Really?
Why were they using fake weights?
So that they had to pay them less.
How did that work, though?
Well, he probably held the weights.
Pay them less if you're putting more weights on, effectively, but the weights aren't worth anything.
Because you can control how much you pay them, because the weights look as if they're doing the job. Oh, okay, well, you get me 4 kilograms of carrots, so you can have this much.
But...
No, I'm with Amanda. I think it would be the opposite.
It's the wrong way around.
Yeah.
Oh,
like,
okay.
if you put, like, one banana on there, and then all of a sudden it's... Well, yeah, maybe that's it. Like, if you put one banana on there and it's 10 pounds, you're getting paid for... You're paying more for that banana, so you would think the weights would... You'd want the weights to be...
Heavier,
yeah.
Yeah.
No, but you put the weights on for decoration, and then you can control it just by going, oh, look, I'm just holding the arm. And you can control how much you pay him. That's the scam.
Well,
surely.
Bottom line, Daniel's a troublemaker. He should have just kept his nose out of the whole thing.
No, he's fine. He needs to go and... Yeah. He needs to go and expose these things. I mean, you know, he's got the back of the American military behind him. He says, all I have to do is do this and do a sign in the air. Next thing you know, you've got 4,000 GIs swarming this place.
Yeah, you would think that that whole village would hate Daniel's guts.
Well, unless they're benevolent, we don't know that the village isn't providing services for the nearby airbase.
Services.
Yeah, but we also dropped a pretty big bomb on that area, you know, that killed a lot of people.
Well, so. I mean, look at when they go into town and they look at the dojo, Sato's dojo. They're all white. He's just training the people from the airbase.
Yeah.
So there's mutual economy. Going.
Daniel needs to go back for some training as well, because he appears to have lost all his karate skills from the first film. Because he gets
beaten up a lot, doesn't he?
Yeah.
That ridiculous scene in the cannery where they swing the hook and he has to try and dodge it. I'd be pretty confident about sidestepping that, to be honest. You just see it coming, move gradually, and that'd be it. But no, it knocks him in the water. Then he gets sucker punched later on in an incident with one of the baddies as well. He's lost all of his skill set. He needs to get himself down there for some training, I think.
And what does he end up doing? He ends up hitting him in the family jewels.
Been a Simpson
trademark for years.
You know, as a child, you're taught, you know, when in fight, have some dignity and some honor. Never go for the ball. It's like it'd be like a boy scratching another boy, wouldn't it? You can't go around hitting people in the balls, can you? That's surely that breaks all sorts of codes of ethics. You know, we just spit at him or something. You know, there's certain things you're not allowed to do. Yeah, smack him in the balls. What a hero.
Well, he needed his money back that he foolishly took out. So
wait till his back's turned and then punch him in the back of the head. That'll have your ancestors nodding on approvingly.
So yeah, oh, we've come up to the natural point. So after we carrot weighing and the scam of the carrot way, did we find it believable the romance between Kimiko, which even when she opens the door, she does that eyebrow thing, which is like, oh, I'm going to linger on Daniel for a bit, even though somebody else is talking to me. That old 80s trope that they roll out. So it's clear that she just fancies him as soon as she sees him. Do we believe the romance? Because they don't really do anything. One kiss.
I do. You know, they were both attracted to each other. I mean, romance could be based on attraction. But I have a feeling that she probably didn't speak English, you know, because, again, it's this whole thing that everybody speaks English.
Yeah.
You know, they should be speaking Japanese in that village. So they probably had nothing in common other than looks, you know, which is fine. I mean, when you go on vacation, that's usually what happens. You know, that's, he basically was on vacation, even though some dude was dying.
I thought that relationship was more one of the more touching parts of the film. I know we've been a bit tough on it so far, but yeah, I found it, you know, quite nice.
She doesn't even go back on the plane with him. So yeah.
Yeah.
We don't know that though at that point.
Yeah, but oh, the bond is that strong and they've done everything that she goes, oh, I've got a call from Tokyo, I'm off. He goes, I had everything lined up for you and I've got loads of cars and stuff. I've got this will here, by the way, that if anything happens to Miyagi, I get the house and the cars. She should have come back in and gone, right, okay, well, if we play our cards right and put some of the powder in his tea over an amount of time, Daniel gets the lot.
That's pretty nice. I was thinking about that. It's like, that's not bad. He could sell those cars.
Make a fortune. Yeah. This isn't Doc Brown and Marty McFly. This isn't that type of relationship. So, but yeah. Can we talk about their Kimiko and Daniel's little date and the poor CGI of the arena? Possibly some of the worst CGI I've seen.
The castle.
The castle, or where they have the final party. And they look down at it. I was like, why didn't you just put a sticker on there, on the lens, and not move the camera?
Oh, is this the end?
Might have been better. No, when they're going down, and she goes, oh, let me show you this arena. It's where we have all our parties and stuff.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Where they used to bone dance.
Where they still do. Oh, that's tickled you, Neil.
That was bad, but the Elvis dancing was even more cringe, I thought, than that, really.
Oh, the 50s?
They just step out of character.
So you know the story behind that? You know why they're like that? Like, because that's actually real. Because they basically, because of World War II, they stayed away from American culture for decades. And they never experienced the 50s. And back in the 80s, I guess, like, the youth started to like kind of let go of their animosity towards the Americans, and they discovered 50s culture, and it was huge over in Japan.
Oh.
People would dress in leather jackets, have slick back hair, girls would be wearing poodle skirts and all that, and they were into, you know, 50s music like Rock Around the Clock and all that. It was just really weird to see it. Like, I saw it on TV, like, where they were experiencing the 50s while it was the 80s, you know. And cool. Yeah, so those did exist, something like that.
Oh, well, that definitely sheds some more light on it. That's a really interesting point. But yeah, I just thought it was a completely random 1950s club that they had in the village. But no, fair play.
I suppose as well, if you've got like the lights of, you know, the Vietnam War and stuff as well, a lot of American culture had infiltrated that area of the world by that point as well, hadn't it?
But then you've got the minor annoyance where Kimiko says earlier on in the film, oh, would you like to dance? And he goes, oh, I think I was off that day. I don't really know how to, right? And then he dances perfectly. And she says to him, oh, where did you learn how to dance? He says, oh, I'm a practice partner for years. Look, mate, you either do or you don't dance. It might be that you don't bone dance, but you do dance. You've got rhythm. That's just annoyance. Yeah, my notes at this point were going like, oh god.
Can we talk about the bit where they attack the Miyagi home and they start to trash the garden? You know, they're kicking up all the vegetables and things. It's just like the campest, lamest thing I've ever seen in my life.
Smashing the bonsai plants.
Yeah, and then I mean, there's such you know, A, the scene's terrible, but B, they're such pantomime baddies, aren't they, that it kind of takes all, you know, I think that's one of the flaws of the film, is they're so one-dimensional. It makes, like, Lord of the Rings look a bit more subtle between good and evil and things. And it takes the jeopardy out of the film as well, because it's just totally obvious what's going to happen, isn't it? That, you know, Miyagi's going to kick their butts, and then it's going to be, you know, it's kind of taking you on rails to the end of the film at this point. But it was...
What, should have firebombed the place?
should have got
I'm surprised that they didn't.
Hardware involved and explored that avenue. I think there's another version of this film where there's some scenes involving the US military which just got, you know, didn't make the final edit. That's an explanation, because otherwise why the hell would you bother introducing it all and then not use it?
That's a bit weird. Yeah.
Maybe like an Eric Stoltz cut of Back to the Future, there's another cut of this film, which is basically let's redo the war. That'd make for a cheery 80s outing.
Yeah, no, but in the end, the pan pipes and the tea ceremonies just edged that out.
So, can we talk about the
storm?
Where the storm comes from? So quickly, I mean, I know we use the term that escalated quickly. That literally was it waiting? I mean,
surely they must have weather forecasts in the '80s.
Maybe it was Godzilla.
I made that same note, Godzilla, yeah. For a typhoon rather than a Godzilla attack. But it must have been, they must have tossed a coin for that one, Charlie, I think, and the best out of three, because they would seem equally contrived.
But it interrupts their tea ceremony, though.
Yeah.
It's really sad, isn't
did
it?
Did he have any tea? I don't think he got to the tea because he was too busy kissing her.
He had a kiss, and then the light blew out just as they'd had their kiss.
I don't know about getting to the T, but just before she got to the D, that's when the typhoon kicked in, I think.
And why, right? Why was a young girl sent to ring the bell up the pole?
I thought she was so scared of the hurricane coming or whatever it was, the typhoon, that she just ran up a tree or a pole.
No, she was the one ringing the bell.
That whole thing just makes no sense.
Why was the bell next to electricity? Why is the bell...
And why do you have to go up the
metal next to electricity?
Surely the rope would be at ground level, so you could just ring the bell at ground level. There's no need to get up in the air then, is there?
Let's be honest, she wasn't that difficult to rescue either, really, was she? He climbed up the ladder, got her, came down, and then flopped around in the mud unconvincingly to allow the uncle to come and rescue him.
It's just raining. It's a bit windy outside. That's it. There isn't like cows flying past like Twister. You know, this is just you need to go out. Okay, well, I'll put my hood up. That's fine. Do you want to jump and I'll catch you?
And the fact that two of their houses like collapsed anyway means they haven't built them very well, have they? Because surely this kind of weather happens a lot. And then they're all in this shelter that's sort of built the same way. And you think, why are all stood in that shelter thing? Because it doesn't look particularly well made either.
Yeah, it was like the three little pigs, like that straw house fell on top of Soto. You know, it's like, well, just get up.
The nephew didn't even look for him, just presumed he was dead.
He's like, Uncle is dead. And then Miyagi comes. Miyagi, your god, you tried to kill me. I hate you forever.
I didn't know Arnold Schwarzenegger was in this.
But the classic karate chop, breaking that big beam.
Yeah. Oh, and that just causes him to forgive him for everything or forget everything. And then, you know, then he's like, can you ever forgive me?
I know, it's like, just so...
There's nothing to forgive, Soto. And it's like, yeah, he threatened your life. He took up all your vegetables.
Yeah,
you know,
threatened to demolish the village, yeah.
Yeah.
Just say, okay.
He's terrified that, terrorized that village, hasn't he? No, there's a lot of that stuff gone down during those decades.
He probably thinks, oh, God, yeah, the storm. I could earn a lot of money now by rebuilding this place with my commercial construction company. That'd be a better option than kind of bulldozing it, because it's all done for me, isn't it, with the storm. Maybe he had a change.
If he hadn't saved him and Sato would have come in and gone, I am not talking to you, but we will wait until the storm dissipates and then we'll have our fight. Surely his bargaining chips just disappeared because the whole place has been decimated. The village has been decimated, so it's taken it away. Mm. So I would go, do your worst, mate. I mean, look at it. It's a shell. Anyway, let's get to the final bit. Why, when they have the final fight, of which he dramatically comes in on a zip wire, and then kicks...
That was a pretty cool scene, though.
Yeah. That's okay. But then when he hits...
No one says anything, though. You know?
No. But when he hits Kimiko, wasn't everyone... Just as you mentioned, Dom, yeah. there are rules in this. And at that point, everyone would have gone, we can jump that easily. They should have all just piled in and basically held his head under the moat. End of film. End of film.
And that water had to be like maybe a foot deep.
You know? Yeah, it wasn't like... deep, was it?
Maybe they didn't want to get their feet wet or something, you know, because, yeah, they could have easily jumped over instead of just sitting watching to see what's happening, or they could have just jumped in the moat and gotten to
absolutely them. A British fight. You would have two guys going at it. The moment that girl who wouldn't be in it, that got hit accidentally, suddenly the whole pub would be, whoa, 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 whoa. And, you know, suddenly the morals will kick in. Nothing like that here. Oh, fine. He might end up, you know, cutting it with his knife and stuff like that,
and no one had a gun. You know, if one person had a gun, they could have shot him, and that would have been the end of it.
What about a pan pipe with a dart in it?
Blow dart,
yeah. That'd be pretty good.
I was just relieved to see some karate at this stage because I'd forgotten it was called The Karate Kid by this film. Might as well just call it The Kid because this is the only martial arts that I can actually remember the whole sorry saga. Yeah,
it didn't last very long either, did it?
And let's be honest, it wasn't, you know, it wasn't Matrix style, was it? It looked pretty badly dated as they're kind of lumbering around, pivoting at the hip to get those kicks in. It was not good.
Well, how old's Daniel at this point? Is he in his early 40s or?
he's getting that deep heat on his back. His lower back pain's kicking in.
Oh, I've got a right jip, which no one will get. No. Do you know what jip means, Joe?
Nope.
It's a nondescript term for just something aches.
Okay.
Oh, I've got a bit of jip in my back. It's a multi-use word.
No, I'll try to use that from now on.
Oh, oh by, down, yeah, Bobby, do. You need to introduce more British aspects into the Sunshine State, Joe.
No. Don't bother using it. Nobody uses it over here.
Anyway, pizza sandwiches. That's all I'm saying. Should we get to... and the film ends abruptly. I mean, it's just... That's your lot. You're not going to see anything.
Right. Why does everyone have a drum?
Yeah.
Well, which Dom pointed, yeah, Dom pointed out. Where did everyone get the drum from?
What? Was it like a secret thing? Bring your drums.
Just in case.
Just in case. Yeah, that's a good idea. Do you not think they would automatically? They might bring a drum and somebody has a flute. They might have loads of things in their back, like Batman's utility belt. They have different things for different occasions. Oh, screw it. Just bring them all.
I'm not sure if it's supposed to be intimidating or profound when they were all stood there with those rattles, but it just looked ridiculous. The whole village looked absurd, yeah.
Wouldn't the guy know what that means? Wouldn't the bad guy know what that means?
He should do.
So he knows that he's about to use the drum effect on him.
Well, I think it was part of their village, and he wasn't part of their village.
Yeah, but he's obviously visited a few times because he weighs carrots, so he must know after a...
For me, they only play drums at night, you know.
I've been the bad guy in their second wind when I'd see them get those out. I thought, God, mate, these really are a bunch of backwards people, aren't they? I'll go for him again.
I always get a kick out of Yuki's face. Like, she's like in complete horror mode. It's like, oh, you know, while all this is going on.
Oh, boy. Anyway, on to trivia time. Should we do trivia time? I'm not going to do it in the voice. Just going to... Okay, Dom, you've done them all. Go on, let's do it again.
Oh, trivia time!
Trivia time!
where's my Oscar nomination?
So, some quick fire ones. The film was shot in Hawaii.
I thought it might have been.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it was weird.
It's not going to be over.
Was that for budget reasons or?
Yeah, it's never, isn't it?
Well, budget reasons.
Went out to Japan.
It earned more at the box office than The Karate Kid.
Did it?
Yeah. I don't know the exact figures, but
what was the budget though? Said.
I don't know. Dom will look this up while I look at it because I have to look at a different screen. So I am looking, but work on the sequel. So this film started 10 days after the release of Karate Kid.
Oh.
So they obviously went, we got a hit here. We're going to put it into production.
That's a smart idea, though, because it was kind of like the first one wasn't on everybody's radar, but it became a hit. Like, a lot of people seen it, so it's like, all right, let's make a sequel. Let's go.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. What's the other bit? I've told you most of these. The construction company and the escort service. The car getting wrecked by Ali off screen. Chosen is the only main antagonist in Karate Kid movies who was offered repeated chances of changing his ways like his uncle, yet he refused belligerently and dishonorably. However, in Cobra Kai Season 3, he has finally changed from his old ways as he's able to reconcile himself, and his honor is eventually restored.
And you said you weren't going to spoil it for us, but you did.
I'm not spoiling it. No, I'm not spoiled anything for you. It's going to be better than... Imagine what you think from Cobra Kai and then go, what am I going to get from a series that's going to reinvent itself? And that's what you get.
Well, no, I do know the story of Chosen in Cobra Kai because my friend told me about it.
Well, so right. You're not spoiled anything. In fact, you can spoil it for me.
No, but I am saying that. No, I remember you talking about it about maybe a half an hour ago and saying, I'm not going to spoil it. And
oh, okay.
You did. That's all I'm going to say. I'm calling you out.
Okay.
Sorry, buddy.
Lastly, because I haven't got much, the opening scenes and obviously the confrontation in the parking lot were in the script for The Karate Kid, but contrary to urban legend, never filmed. They were shot specifically for this film. So there we have it. Not a lot, really. That's not a real lot to say about it. So, I mean, we don't do averages on here, but what did we have? A 4, a 5, a 4, and a 7? Did you give it a 7?
6.
That's about right. Won't be watching it again.
Yeah, it's about a 5.
I might stick Karate Kid when I'm doing some admin this week. I might stick part 3 on in the background.
No, I do want to watch the first one and probably the third one, maybe even the fourth one.
Ugh. So you only get one character back from the whole series. That smacks of just desperation when you only get Mr. Miyagi back. That's it.
Yeah, but Hilary Swank went on to do great things. Oh. So seeing her in her early career.
Well, anyway, that's it. That's what we've got. But I do have to ask you a question. It's more about scheduling. But I think it's something that the listeners might want to know. I think we need to do a film before we do our Christmas film. Because the Christmas film this year is going to be Die Hard 2. I thought we're doing two Christmas films.
I'm really into Christmas this year. I've got it for whatever. I've got Christmas fever and it's still in November. And I want to sit here with a big vat of mulled wine and do... 3 Christmas films. I don't even think 2's enough. 3 Christmas films.
Well, we need to do one. Well, actually, no, I was going to say we'll do Aliens before we do Christmas films. Is it too early to do? No, because by the time we record Christmas films, it'll be December. Do you know what? Let's get on the Christmas film. Let's do it. Let's do a couple.
Now you've said Aliens. I want to do Aliens if Amanda does Aliens, because I want to have some... Otherwise, it'll just be the three of us kind of praising it, and I want Amanda to come here and tell us why.
I don't want to watch it.
Because you don't like it, or you just don't like
it? I don't like them.
She'll have nightmares
about
it.
I've seen it twice, but I just don't like them. They give me the creeps.
When was the last time you saw it?
A while ago.
All right. I was going to ask. I was watching Batman Returns the other night. So is Batman
That's
92. Returns?
92.
I understand that, but is that a Christmas movie?
Yes.
Oh please!
No, the entire time is set at Christmas. There is
doesn't make it a Christmas movie.
There's a big Christmas tree. There's Christmas presents going everywhere.
We won't review it because it's in the '90s.
No,
I know we're not going to review it, but I know Charlie has this whole thing that Die Hard is a Christmas movie.
It is.
He said it is not.
Here we go.
Yeah.
It is. One of the things that I saw was in Birmingham, and they're showing a special showing of Die Hard. It's on a Wednesday evening, in about 3 weeks' time, whereby they put, it sounds the weirdest thing in the world. It's a small theatre next to the Utility Arena. I forgot the name of it, the Hummingbird or something, and they're showing Die Hard with a choice of five wines. So they'll bring you wines throughout the film while you're watching Die Hard. Tickets are £26. I was like, oh, I'd like to see Die Hard in a situation I'd never seen it before. And somebody just bringing me wine and keep topping up my glass.
You know, I'm really in the mood for a drink now, I have to say. I don't know if it's that little anecdote or just talking about Christmas or whether it's just 20 to 4 in the afternoon, so it's time for a pint. But yeah, I'm looking forward to a drink.
Oh, I'm going swimming.
Sunday as well.
But then I'll have a drink, yes.
Yeah, I wouldn't have wine while I'm watching Die Hard. Maybe a beer.
Yeah,
well, somebody's come up with an idea. I just thought it's crazy enough that it might actually do. So we're going to do Die Hard 2 is one of them. Shall we all have a discussion after this what the other one should be?
Yeah, can't be afraid.
Have we got any suggestions you want to throw out at the moment? Any off the top of your head?
Do they have to be sequels?
They do. Well, actually,
no.
No, they don't.
You can break from tradition, you know.
Yeah, yeah. And we'd Die Hard 2, we'd nod the Christmas film for the sequel. So yeah, we can have another one.
But a real Christmas film.
I want to do Muppet Christmas Carol, but that's in the 90s, so we can't.
92. Sorry. Are we allowed to, are we allowed to skip out? We should be able to break out now and again.
Home Alone, we could do Elf. Are we talking about the Christmas staples? Is that...
We do one where we get Amy on, and Amy can come on.
Yeah.
Let's do Prancer again.
No.
That might actually be the worst film I've ever seen.
I still haven't seen it.
It might be. But anyway, well, I'm sure we'll come up with something. And whatever, it'll be a Christmas classic. I know I would have mentioned Scrooged, and I know nobody else would go for that, so...
I was thinking of watching it. Yeah.
I like Scrooged.
Love Scrooged. It's not Christmas without Scrooged. The Snowman. What, walking in the air?
Yeah.
That's not a film. That's like a short... It's like half an hour or so. Not going to be a lot to discuss.
I like that.
The snowman picks him up. They go flying and he drops him back and he melts.
Yeah. And trivia time would suck. I mean, not trivia. And so would Roll Call.
Alan Jones, yes, went to disgrace himself at the BBC.
Wasn't David Bowie, wasn't he part of that at some point?
Don't know. Well, we might be starting to build a trivia time, but with the shortest podcast we ever do, we'd have to talk about something else. Do you know what? How about this? And this sounds like a conversation we should have, but I think it's a good idea. Why don't we have mince pies and mulled wine while we do the podcast?
That ain't happening. Why not? Here.
Wait. Nope. Why?
Mince pie? Are you out of your mind?
Wait a minute. No. What do you... That's not an American... Here we go. What do you have over there? I don't know. An almond tart.
For Christmas?
We celebrate Christmas with an almond tart.
What
confectionery do you have?
I don't know. Cookies? That's all I can think of. Candy canes? Candy canes?
What?
But no, mince pie, we've never... I don't even think that exists over here. We have fruitcake.
It does. You have mince meat.
But no one eats it.
You have mince meat.
But not in pie.
Well, just can't you make one? Just for us?
No. Why not? Because it sounds disgusting. It's like I wasn't grown on that. So there's no way I'm going to have mince pie. Sorry. I mean, I'll watch you eat it.
It goes into a food discussion, doesn't it?
What do you have for Christmas Day? Just indulge me, and then we'll finish. Honestly, we'll finish the podcast.
I think you indulge me. Turkey.
What does a Christmas meal have? Right. Turkey. So, okay, that's good.
Like Scrooge, you know. I mean, Well, he had turkey or goose or whatever the hell he had.
I said to Amanda, I would love a Thanksgiving over here. I'd love to eat what you eat at Thanksgiving because it all sounds amazing.
Is it pumpkins or something revolting then?
It's mostly turkey. No, it's turkey, cranberry sauce, mashed potatoes,
mashed potatoes, corn. And turkey, yeah.
I don't know if the Indians made that, but that's what they're telling us.
Right, well, on that bombshell, the cultural differences continue. They still don't put butter on the sandwiches, Philistines. Anyway, right, so we'll be back with a Christmas film next. So we'll look forward to it. So I will say I have had really good fun on this. I don't think I've laughed like that for a long time. So, yes, thank you very much. And I do apologise to listeners. If you want to go and see it, I mean, yeah, you can go and watch. We're actually getting a load of traction. Lethal Weapon 2 got loads of views on YouTube. So, yeah, go and watch by all means. But anyway, I will say cheerio.
Sayonara.
See ya.
Toodle pip.
Bye.